Welcome back to the NGP course Seismic Full Waveform Inversion. In the last tutorial I created a very simple subsurface model using the Denise Python IO Jupyter notebook. It was simply a layer over a half space, and the purpose was to demonstrate how easy it is actually to define model parameters and the subsurface model and also the acquisition geometry, and then run actually a seismic forward modeling. While the subsurface model was quite simple, the resulting shot gather for the PSV case was quite complex. Yeah, so we simply excitated vertical point sources at the free surface, and for example for the first shot we get this shot gather over here, which shows the direct wave, then also a surface wave, in this case it's a Rayleigh wave because it's a PSV case. Then we also have the reflection from the boundary between the first layer and the half space. Then we also have a refracted wave. Then we have a multiple reflection. We see it occurs at exactly twice the time of the first reflection. However, then there are additional reflections that we see here where we are not really sure what they are. So there could be S-wave reflection, but there could be also P to S converted waves. So it's not easy to see what's really going on here. To help a little bit with the interpretation of this shot gather, we can also export the wave field propagation within the whole model. This shot gather only recorded the vertical displacement velocity at specific positions on the numerical grid. So it's not really easy to understand what's really happening in the whole medium. And in order to understand this a little bit easier, we can now export also wave field snapshots for the whole model and create also a nice wave field movie from these shots. So this will be actually the topic of this video, and it will also help you with the last task that was mentioned here in exercise number one. So let's go straight into the problem. So we go back onto my desktop computer here, open the NGP full waveform inversion folder. Go into our third folder, do it yourself, and let's create a new input file specifically for exporting the whole wave field. To achieve this, we only have to change our Denise Python IO Jupyter notebook. And perhaps in order to understand a little bit better what we have done, let's rename this. Let's call it 001 Denise Python IO. So this was actually the first step, to simply compute the shot gathers. And now we create a new Jupyter notebook. Actually we are only modifying this one, so we copy it and insert it again, and then rename it to, let's say, Snap. Yeah, because we need a specific parameter file only to produce these snapshots. So we can now reproduce actually what we have done. So first we created our simple subsurface model and calculated synthetic seismograms. And then we exported the snapshots, and then later on we'll create also a nice movie. Okay, let's open the Anaconda prompt, go to desktop or wherever you have placed your NGP for waveform inversion folder, then start Jupyter notebook. Okay, so let's go again into our folder here. Open the second Jupyter notebook, which is now used for creating the snapshot files. So we simply rename now our file name here for the input file. Let's call it snap. And then also change perhaps the description. Let's call it snapshots for layer over half space model. Okay, so now that was really easy. We only changed here the output file name and the description. Now we have to activate actually the output of the wavefield snapshots. So we go down here, it's step number 9, wavefield snapshots. And because we have the PSV case, where we are modeling P waves as well as vertical polarized shear waves, let us output the curl and divergence, so the P and S wave energy of the wave field. So let's take snap equals 3. Then we want to output the snapshots only for the first shot. So that is snapshot equals 1. Then we have to define the time at which we want to export the first snapshot in seconds. This is 0.002. We could actually leave that, I think, because the condition is that it has to be larger than the time step dt. So let's check again what the time step dt was. Yeah, it was 1.6 times 10 to the power of minus 3 seconds. So this is definitely larger. So let's leave it at 0.02 seconds. And this is not the first snapshot, this is actually the last snapshot. The last snapshot, yeah, perhaps we should check again the shot gather. So the last snapshot should actually contain all the stuff that we are actually interested in. So we are especially interested in these curious reflections or converted waves or whatsoever. But actually everything is interesting up to 6 seconds. So let's export everything from 0.02 seconds up to 6 seconds. And then I want to produce 50 snapshots. So we have to calculate here the increment. So you can simply divide 6 by 50 or something like that. So we can add a new cell and then simply use it as calculator. 60 divided by 50, 0.2. That's actually only an approximation because we didn't start it at 0 but 0.02, but anyway. Perhaps we can reduce it. So to be more accurate, it has to be something like that. Oh, wait a second, that's wrong. Okay, so it's 0.1199. Okay, doesn't matter. So let's take 0.12. Okay. So now we have defined the snapshot increment in seconds, and everything else I think we can leave at the default option. So the base name for the snapshots will be waveform forward, and they will be exported into the snap directory. Okay, so let's simply run this Jupyter notebook again. Okay, so it's now finished. So let's take a look into our folder here. So actually the only thing that is interesting for us now is this new input parameter file, the full waveform inversion workflow file, and all the models and PDF files are actually not really interesting. Also the receiver OBC, source OBC, VSP. we already have created all these files, so we can actually delete them. So in the next step, we have to copy our new parameter file to the NEC cluster. Very easy. So first of all, I log into the NEC cluster. Oops, wrong password. Okay, so I go back to the working directory. Then we used Denise layer something, layer over half space, right? And we go back into the par directory, and now I have to copy the new parameter file from my desktop computer to the working directory. So I have to change here the it's work one actually. Okay, Denise layer over half space. We go into the par directory and copy our new Denise layer over half space OBC snap input file. Okay, so this should now be updated. Right, so we now have also this snap file. Let's check if actually the snap options are all implemented correctly. Perhaps I should have done this before, but it's better to check it before we run it instead of never checking it. So snapshots. That's the wrong file. Okay. That's the old parameter file. We have to use snap point input. Obviously, in this one, we only want to export the seismograms. And here we have now, right, specifically a parameter file to export the snapshots. So we have snap equals 3, which means we are exporting the curl and divergens energy for shot number 1. And the first snapshot will be exported at 2 milliseconds, the last at 6 milliseconds, and the increment will be 0.12 seconds. Okay, that seemed to be correct. And because I'm too lazy to create actually a new job file, I'm simply running it on the login node, which you actually should only do for test purposes. But because this is a test purpose, I will do it. So let's simply use mpi run mp30 bin denise layer, and then you have to be sure that you are choosing here the correct input file. So it's snap.input, and as you can see now, we are running only one shot, so this only took 4 seconds or 3.85 seconds on 30 cores. And as you can see, at each of these time steps here, the complete wave field, so the divergence and the z component of the curl, was actually exported into this snap directory here. So you see here 5.8816 seconds and so on. Yeah, so all these snapshots are now located in the par directory and in the subdirectory snap. So let's take a look into this directory. And you can see now the base name file, waveform underline forward dot bin dot div. So these are the divergence files. And then you can see that we have now multiple files actually for the divergence and the curl of the wave field. Remember, the whole model was decomposed into different parts. So in this case, 10 subdomains in x direction and 3 subdomains in y direction, and then each subdomain was actually assigned to a specific CPU core. So each CPU core has now exported the wave field for the respective subdomain. So we have now 30 files for the divergence and 30 files for the curl. Now we have to merge all this stuff together, yeah, because we don't want to look at the specific wave fields in each subdomain. We want to look at the wave field for the whole model again. And to achieve this, we have to compile a small utility program. So we go back into the PAR directory, and from the PAR directory, one directory up, and then to the source directory. And here we make now this helper function. It's called snapmerge. So make snapmerge. Okay, so that was quite easy to compile. We go back into the binary directory, and there you can see beside the Denise binary, we now have this snapmerge binary. And with this, it is quite easy to actually merge all these individual files into the wave fields for the whole computational domain. So we go back into the PAR directory. And now we simply start this snapmerge code. So it's simply snapmerge. And then we have to define the name of the input file. So it's Denise layer over half space OBC, and then very important, snap point input. And it will take now all the parameters from this input file and will merge actually all the wave fields from the subdomains into one large binary file, which contains now the wave field for the whole domain. So this is located again in the snap directory. So if I'm doing list here again, you see now beside these wave fields for all the subdomains, we now have this file here. So this contains all the wave field information for the whole domain, in this case the divergence wave field, and this is for the third component of the curl of the displacement wave field. Okay, we can also look at the size of these files. As you can see, the size for each subdomain is only 2.3 megabytes. And yeah, for the whole domain it is now 67 megabytes. Nice. So the next step is to actually copy these results for the whole domain back onto our desktop computer. So I go back here into our 003 Denise Do It Yourself folder and create a new folder called Snap. So as usual, I want to be consistent with the name convention on my desktop computer and on the NEC cluster. So I open here the snap folder on my desktop computer, and I'm also open the snap folder on the NEC cluster, and then simply copy first the divergence wave field. And as soon as this is finished, I also copy the curl of the wave field, so more precisely the Z component of the curl. Okay, so even though I have a 1000 Mbit per second internet connection, it took actually quite some time to download these two 67 megabyte files. So next we go back into our Denise Do It Yourself folder. And now we need a Jupyter notebook to actually visualize our snapshots. And this is also included in the Denise distribution. So we go here back into our Denise folder, back into the PAR directory. and then into the visualization subdirectory. And here I have a Jupyter notebook called Snap Marmusi Diff Rot. Yeah, can simply copy that from the cluster to our desktop computer and then start this Jupyter notebook. Okay, so first we import a lot of libraries, blah blah blah. And then we have to define some parameters, which we already defined in the input file. So actually we can go back into the Jupyter notebook, which we used to create our input file. And first we have to look at the model discretization. So what was actually the number of grid points in X and Y direction, and what was actually the DH? Yeah, and you see now we have this NX and Y and DH, and we have to define the same here. So actually it was the same as the Marmusi model, but only scaled down. So for simplicity reasons, I will do the same stuff. So I reduce the spatial discretization by a factor of 2. I will increase the number of grid points in X and Y direction by a factor of 2. More generally, you would obviously write dh, nx, and ny, and not do something like this. But in this case, let's do it. Okay, then we have to define here the wave field snapshot parameters. So actually, we have to define first these parameters, because these are already also defined in the input file. So we go back to step number 9 into the definition of our Denise parameter file. Yeah, here in the section wave field snapshots. So we have to define tsnap1, tsnap2, and tsnapinc. tsnap1 was 0.02, that's still correct. tsnap2 was 6 seconds instead of 3. So let's change that. And the tsnap increment was 0.12 seconds, something like that. And then we know that the first snapshot is actually 1, and the last snapshot is 50. So these are simply the number of snapshots that we have. And the snapshot increment should be at 1. Now, in order to optimize the visualization, it's always a good idea to start only with a few snapshots. So let's say we only want to look at the first 5 snapshots at the moment, because we have to adapt actually these parameters here, clip diff and clip rot, for the different wave fields. So let's start with 5 snapshots. So all these parameters can be actually extracted from the definition in the Denise parameter file. Okay, then we have some fonts here. Maybe you have to adapt the figure size to your given problem. So this is only true here for the Marmusi model, or the layer over the half space model, which is actually only a simplified version of the Marmusi model. In the next step, we have to define the p-wave velocity model, even though I call it here s-wave velocity model, so let's call it p-wave velocity. Okay, so this should be in the start directory. So if we go back into our Denise do it yourself directory, in the start directory, we have here these layer over half space models, and we are interested in this VP model. So I'm simply copying here the base name and change it to our layer over half space. Everything else should be correct, so the NX and NY number of grid points in x and y direction are defined here above. And now it should import this p-wave velocity model. And then I have written a small function where we can import the snapshot for a given offset. Offset in this case means at a different time. Now the snapshots for all the time steps are simply concatenated in this binary stream. So we can actually extract now all the different snapshots by defining an offset. So this is the reason why we have this parameter offset here. And I simply open now the different snapshot files. So first file is for the divergence, the second is for the curl. Then I define the data type again. This is again IAAA little endian floating point numbers. And then depending on the offset, I can choose what kind of time step I want to import. So this is actually this offset snap. So for example, if I don't want to import the first snapshot but the second, then offset would be 2. And then I can actually explicitly import this part of the binary file. So this is done with this numpy function memmap. So it's a little bit complicated. If you're interested in the details, you can search for numpy memmap. So this explicitly imports now the specific snapshots with a specific offset here. And then it will transpose and flip up down it in order to visualize that in the next step. Okay, I'm doing this here for the divergence snapshots and then also for the curl snapshots. And I'm returning then the snapshots for this specific offset, or more specifically for this specific time step. Okay. Then I define my axis, so the x and y axis, and convert them from meters to kilometers. And here I'm actually now visualizing my results. So what is the most important part? I have here a while loop over my number of snapshots. So I'm starting here at the first snapshot, and this while loop will only be valid up to the last snapshot, obviously. Then I define my offset, and from this index here I can calculate my current time of the snapshot using the tsnap1 and the tsnap increment values. Then I load the snapshot for the specific offset here. I simply call this function here and get the divergence snapshot and the curl snapshot. And then I simply visualize them using subplot. So here I'm visualizing the curl wave, the divergence wave field. And what I'm doing is I'm first plotting the p-wave velocity model as the background model in with a grayscale color map. And then I superimpose in a semi-transparent way the divergence snapshot on the VP model. So this can be really easily done with this plot-im-show function in Python. And the transparency, or the opacity to be more precise, is defined by this alpha value here. So I have now the background model in gray, and the wave field snapshot is plotted in a semi-transparent way over this VP model. There's also a nice color map for visualizing seismic wave fields as part of this matplotlib library, and that's called seismic. Really nice. Then I can define here also the clipping values. I think we have to adapt them to the specific problem. And the rest is more or less adding a title, adding access annotations. I'm also adding, as you can see here, a timestamp, so that I know at which time actually this snapshot was recorded. Then I'm doing the same stuff for the Z component of the curl. And finally, I export the snapshot as a PNG file. Maybe we call it not Marmoozy, but layer over half space, but actually it doesn't matter. Over half space. Snap. Yeah, and then I go to the next snapshot with the DS snap, and so on and so on until I reach here the last snapshot. So in this case, it's from 1 to 50. Okay, so let's do that. Let's see what's happening. I think it will result in an error message because we also have to define this directory called pix. So I want to avoid that the pictures are all exported here in the main directory of our Denise Do It Yourself folder. So I have to create a new folder called pictures. And now we can run this stuff. Okay, there's only some warnings. And let's take a look into the pictures directory. See, it's already finished because we only exported the first 5 snapshots. And you see in the grayscale the background model. So in this case I only imported the p-wave velocity model because I don't have any structural changes between the p and the s-wave velocity model. Of course, if you have significant differences, I would recommend to use the p-wave velocity model for the p-wave energy and the s-wave velocity model for the s-wave energy. Okay, so we really easily see now in grayscale here the layer over the half space, but nothing really spectacular has happened now. If I go now through these snapshots, so this is the second snapshot at 122 milliseconds, then 242 milliseconds, 362, and 482. We see it's quite not spectacular, so actually nothing is visible here. And the reason is not that we have made an error in the parameter file. The problem might be the clipping of the wave field. So the amplitudes of this p-wave energy and s-wave energy may be actually very small. And currently, if we go up into our Snap Jupyter notebook here, the clipping values are set to 1. So the clipping value for divergence and rotation is 1, and maybe we have to decrease them a little bit. Now, in order to find reasonable values, I will simply take the maximum of one of the snapshots, so NumPy dot max of the divergence field, for example. And there we can see the amplitude is indeed much by orders of magnitude smaller than 1. So let's say 1 times 10 to the power of minus 7. We can also look at the maximum of the curl field. Yeah, it's in the same order. Okay, so let's change simply the clipping values from 1 to 1 times 10 to the power of minus 7, and the same for the curl wave field. Oops. Nah, okay, it doesn't matter. Okay, so I've now changed the clipping and we can run the notebook again and see what's happening. Aha, I already see there is something happening. Okay, so first snapshot still looks quite unspectacular. And in the second snapshot, we now see how the wave propagates here from our source position. So this is now the P wave. This is the S wave, which is actually obviously a little bit slower. Okay. Yeah, so this is what we actually would expect. So we already see here the nice P wave. We can see a little bit here the Rayleigh wave in the P wave field, but it's actually more obvious in the S wave energy. Okay, so these were the first five snapshots, so not really interesting now. So let's see what happens if we really export all the 50 snapshots. So let's do that. So we go back into our wave field snapshot parameters and change nsnap2 from 5 to 50 so that we export really all the snapshots that we have. Okay, so this is now running and we are now at 6, 7 and so on. So this might take some time, but let's take a look at snapshot number 7. You see now here after 722 milliseconds we have reached the PML boundary frame. And as I mentioned already a few times, inside the PML boundary, very unphysical stuff is actually happening. So as you can see here in the S-wave energy, there is traveling a quite fast S-wave within the PMLs. So again, I want to emphasize, do not place sources or receivers inside the PMLs. You already see here in the snapshots, there's something very funky going on inside these PML layers. Okay, now we have 17, so let's take a look at the first snapshots. As you can see, we have now a really nice wave propagation movie. You can also see that while we have these funky effects within the PMLs, there are actually no significant boundary reflections here from the left boundary. So that's really nice. So what can we see now? So after about 1 second, we are reaching here with the P wave, this interface between the first layer and the half space. And we start to see a reflected wave after 1.2 seconds. And what we now can also really nicely see is that we have S-wave energy occurring here at the interface as soon as the P-wave reaches this interface. So this is obviously converted P to S-wave energy, because the S-wave itself has not reached this interface yet, but the P-wave. So this is a really nice way to understand P to S wave energy conversion at the interface here. Really nice way to visualize that. And by the way, there is another P to S conversion, and that's this curious wave here. So that is P to S conversion at the free surface boundary condition that we see here. So this is really interesting. What you can also see is here the surface wave that is attached to the free surface, and that's traveling with a little bit slower speed as the S wave that we have here, the direct S wave. So this is also quite interesting. So we see the physics seem to be modeled more or less correctly. Okay, that is a very subjective comparison, but basically we can see that the general physics seem to be correct. And by the way, we can also talk about the radiation characteristics of the vertical impact source, which obviously creates a P wave that is radiated here downwards. So we have a lot of P wave energy here. But exactly here at 90 degrees relative to the surface, we have more or less no S wave energy. So that's also quite interesting. Okay, so we can go back to the next time step. So we now have here a reflected P wave, and we have this converted P to S wave. Yeah, so if we go further on in time, we see now, okay, we don't see it, but I think if we update now the snapshots and go back into this, yeah, right. Then we see here the reflected wave from the interface. Actually, we have to call it the first reflection, because more reflection will follow. And here we have the P to S converted wave. What's also starting to appear is this wave over here. So this is the refracted wave. It's also quite interesting. We have a refracted P wave over here, and we have the refracted S wave over here. Well, actually, I think this is the refracted S wave. This is some converted stuff again. Yeah, and as you can see now, we have now also another conversion. Now the direct S wave is hitting here the interface, and we have now a conversion of S wave energy into P wave energy. Yeah, so suddenly, as soon as the S wave hits here the interface, we see that P wave energy is appearing here at the interface. Then of course we also get the reflected S wave again, and the converted S to P wave is traveling up here. Okay, and next, the reflection from this interface is reflected again here at the free surface, and we've got a reflection that's traveling down again. The same for the P to S converted wave. Yeah. And so on and so forth. So all the reflections and multiple reflections can now be in detail actually understood by looking at these snapshots. You see, while the model is quite simple, this layer over half space, the resulting wave field is actually quite complicated, because we use this PSV physics in our Denise forward modeling code. You can now also clearly see here the refracted S wave. You can also see that we have interface waves here that are stick to the interface between the layer and the half space, which are obviously traveling with a smaller velocity than the waves that are traveling directly in the medium. And if we go back perhaps to one of the first snapshots, you also see that the wavelength is actually increasing. Yeah, so here in the upper medium in the layer, the wavelength is smaller than in the half space, which actually confirms that the model was also correctly imported. Yeah, in the top layer we had a p-wave velocity of 1500 meters per second, and in the half space it was, I think, 3000 meters per second. So that's really nice. So take a closer look on what's actually going on. So what we have is we have direct P and S waves, we have refracted P and S waves, we have converted P to S and S to P, and then we have multiple reflections because we have a free surface boundary condition. And then we also have interface waves. So first of all we have the surface wave, and then also here these waves that are sticking to this interface actually. So, as I mentioned before, a very, very complex wave field. We are now at shot snapshot number 46, and the Jupyter notebook is still running. Now at 47. As you can see, the wave field is now really complicated. So what might be also a good idea, and I suggest that you add this function to this Jupyter notebook, is to plot actually the receiver positions. Yeah, so that you can really identify at which time which type of wave is actually arriving at which receiver. Okay, there's a lot of witches. So this is really useful in order to understand really your seismogram. Yeah, because it's not really a simple P wave, S wave, but you also have a lot of converted and multiple reflected waves. So to understand really the seismogram, it is really helpful to visualize the complete propagation of the whole seismic wave field within the model. And in this case, it's specifically useful to really separate the P wave energy from the S wave energy. And you can really easily do this by computing the divergence and the curl of the displacement wave field. If you're interested in more details, I think I described the mathematics in the Denise manual in more detail. And finally, we have visualized all 50 time steps. You see, it's really, really weird, this wave field, even though the model is extremely simple. But now we have more or less understood of what's going on. You only have to compare now this with the, where was it, our shot gather. What's this PDF file here? So now you can really look into the snapshots here and compare them with the arrival times of the different waves. So for example, what is this curious wave here? Okay, I'm now not sure where the receiver is located. I think it should be somewhere over here. Yeah, so this receiver here, okay, at zero offset, it should be more or less at zero. I think it's... okay, there was... You have to be careful, this axis is actually not correct, that's offset. So I think the first receiver was at 800 meters or something like that, so it should be here. So what happens at 2 seconds? There should be something arriving, and we see if we propagate this wave here back, so it's this wave actually here at 2 seconds. We can now propagate the time backwards and see this is indeed actually the P wave reflection. Yeah, you see it here. Then we have another arrival here shortly before 3 seconds. And as you can see, this is this wave here. Most likely it could be also this wave actually. So it's hard to tell, they are interfering with each other. So it's either this wave, which is simply the PS converted wave, or it is this one, which is an SP converted wave. Hard to tell. 2.761, and this is also arriving here. So this should be analyzed in more detail in order to understand this reflection, which might be actually not an refraction but a conversion. And then at 3.5 seconds, there's also something going on. 3.61, this one. This is definitely one, this wave over here, and this is the reflected S wave. So this is definitely the reflected S wave. Here we are not really sure, and at 4 seconds, which should be here, there's only one wave, and that is this wave over here. And that is, I think, the multiple reflection. Right. So this was the first reflection, then it is reflected again here at the free surface, then the reflection is going back downward and reflected again at the interface, and at 4 seconds it's reaching the geophone. And that makes sense because that's exactly 2 times the travel time of the first P-wave reflection, which was at 2 seconds. So you can see these wave field snapshots are really useful to understand what's going on in your seismograms. Yeah, even though they look more or less simple, it's really helpful to understand these different wave field snapshots. Now, of course, you can scroll through all these snapshots. That's actually quite useful also in talks. But maybe we also want to produce some animation from these snapshots. And there are actually different ways on how to do that. And one approach is to use a program that I'm actually using for my astronomy stuff. And that's called PIP. So PIP is a open source software that you can download from the homepage. So you have to search for PIP. And it is actually, where is it here? PIP, Planetary Imaging Preprocessor. And you can install it on Windows, or you can install it on Linux using Wine. So it's not really a Linux code, but it's using this Wine emulator. Yeah, so you can simply download it under Windows and then install it. So actually this is for processing planetary images, but you can also use it to produce really nice time-lapse animations or animated GIFs. And it's free software, so it's quite easy to use. An alternative would be LR Timelapse. However, this is a commercial software and it is not really cheap. I think it costs 150 euros or something like that. But the advantage of LR Timelapse is that it can also output videos in 4K resolution, something like that, and at higher frame rates. But actually for these simple animations it's actually not necessary. So we can rely on PIP. So simply open PIP. Then we add image files, and there we simply import our snapshot files, all 50, open, okay. This can be actually closed. Then we can go into, what do we want to change? Animation options. This should be okay, so play all frames in forward order. You can also reverse the order after reaching the end of the movie, but that looks a little bit curious. So this is more for planetary images. And at the output options, you can choose between AVI and animated GIFs, or SER, which is actually more a file format used by planetary observers. So let's produce an animated GIF. And at the advanced options, you should choose maximum quality. And then simply go to do processing and start processing. And then it will simply create an animated GIF from the snapshot images. Yeah, it will be then located in our pics folder. So you can see here PIP has created this subfolder using PIP and some curious integer numbers. Okay, processing is complete. And we have now this animated GIF. It's also not too large, only 5 megabytes. And we can open the animated GIF using, for example, Photos, I think. Yeah, then you have this animated GIF. where you can now really nicely see the wave propagation. Quality is also quite nice. And it's not running too fast. So it's not actually running in real time, where it would be really complicated to interpret all these arrivals and reflections and so on. Of course, if you want to have a little bit smoother frame rate, you have to export more frames, which would obviously also result in a larger movie file, but then it will not have this very low frame rate. Yeah, but in terms of interpretation, I think this is already quite nice. We could also export an AVI file. So if we go to output format AVI and start processing again, then we get a second folder which contains now the AVI, which is 108 megabytes. Okay, so forget about the AVI. I think this is uncompressed AVI. And that's now also in real time. So this is obviously not a really good option. Yeah, so let's open this with the movie player. Yeah, so you have to repeat the movie over and over again, but actually this is not a good option because this is now really animated in real time. And the quality is actually not that much better. So yeah, it's not really in real time, so it's a little bit faster than real time. Yeah, so this would be more or less real time seismic wave propagation. Okay. I think in the output options you can also define how many frames you want to use. But yeah, the AVI option is not really that ideal because yeah, the files are really large. So if you do that, you have to then convert the AVIs to MP4 or something like that. And then I think it will be comparable to the animated GIF. Okay, so now I have shown you how to produce these really nice snapshot files and assemble them into a snapshot movie using animated GIFs. And as you have seen, we can now really nicely interpretate also our shot gathers with these movies. So it's a really helpful tool to actually understand what's going on. And we have also seen that even though the model is quite simple, solving the problem for the PSV case is actually quite complicated. So the resulting wave field is really, really complicated. Yeah, so we not only have reflections and refractions, we also have converted waves. So P to S and S to P converted waves. And that's also one reason why the full waveform inversion of the PSV case is much more complicated than the full waveform inversion of, for example, SH waves. Yeah? And that's also the reason why we will later on only invert an SH data set. Okay. And with this nice animation, I finish this tutorial. I thank you for your attention, and hopefully we will see each other in the next tutorial. Bye for now.